In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
It is good to be in this beautiful cathedral, and so beautifully decorated with the flowers of spring, but most importantly, made all the more beautiful by the faith of God's people, gathered to sing his praise and to rejoice at his resurrection. My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask, Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, who on this day, through your only begotten Son, have conquered death and unlocked for us the path to eternity, grant, we pray, that we who keep the solemnity of the Lord's resurrection may, through the renewal brought by your Spirit, rise up in the light of life, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter proceeded to speak and said, "You know what has happened all over Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power. He went about doing good and healing all those oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. This man God raised on the third day and granted that he be visible, not to all the people, but to us, the witnesses chosen by God in advance, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commissioned us to preach to the people and testify that he is the one appointed by God as judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him will receive forgiveness of sins through his name." The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brothers and sisters, if then you were raised with Christ, seek what is above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Think of what is above, not of what is on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, your life, appears, then you too will appear with him in glory. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O
Lord. On the first day of the week, Mary of Magdala came to the tomb early in the morning while it was still dark and saw the stone removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple whom Jesus loved and told them, "They have taken the Lord from the tomb and we do not know where they put him." So Peter and the other disciple went out and came to the tomb. They both ran, but the other disciple ran faster than Peter and arrived at the tomb first. He bent down and saw the burial cloths there, but did not go in. When Simon Peter arrived after him, he went into the tomb and saw the burial cloths there, and the cloth that had covered his head, not with the burial cloths, but rolled up in a separate place. Then the other disciple also went in, the one who had arrived at the tomb first, and he saw and believed, for they did not yet understand the scripture that he had to rise from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord.
Kindly be seated. At the Easter Vigil, the Exultet is a great prayer, a song, that proclaims the good news of Easter on the night in which the Lord was raised from the dead. And that text uses a title for Jesus that is found certainly in the scriptures and in our tradition, but uses it several times. And it appears also in the prayers of Easter. It refers to the Lord Jesus as our Redeemer. Our Redeemer. You know this language. You've heard it many times in your life, I'm sure. But have you ever thought, though, how strange it is that we acclaim Jesus, the one who redeems us from sin and death, and people redeem coupons? It's an odd coincidence in a way, right? How is it that we get this kind of language for coupons? Well, the language originates in the story of Israel, and it did, in fact, have, at least in its first iteration, a financial association. In the ancient world, there was a great deal of violence, a lot of conflict, tribal, national, warlords. It was fairly common for people to see their land invaded and to have relatives kidnapped and even sold into slavery. And of course, in the ancient world, people couldn't rely on social services or clinics or police forces or anything else to help them in these times of great emergency. And so there arose in Israel a tradition of having a designated member of the family, the extended family or tribe, who would be the redeemer, the goel in Hebrew. And the purpose of the redeemer was if one of your family members or even several were kidnapped or captured in a battle and sold into slavery, it was your job to track them down and to buy them back, to pay money, to bring them back, to bring them home, to liberate them and restore them to their family. That's where this language first arises, within the practice of the family. because family was so important in that ancient world where there was really nothing else. And so that image of the Redeemer eventually extended to other kinds of activities, like helping family members who found themselves without work, or in famine, or in times of natural disaster. It became a way in which people helped each other through suffering and death and liberating people from slavery. All of these things within the life of the family. But the prophets, they take up this language and they begin to speak of God as Redeemer to Israel, the Goel to Israel. The greatest is probably the prophet Isaiah, who uses this title very frequently. It's drawn again from ordinary family life in Israel, but it is now infused with a deeper meaning. Because this title now applied to God says something rather radical. It says God is part of our family. If God is to be Redeemer for Israel, that is a role within the family. And so what the prophets announce is that God would be a member of the family, and that God cares so much for the family that the Lord wants to redeem, wants to save, wants to help, wants to liberate. Of course, the great story of the Exodus of Israel gives us this to the nth degree, as literally the Lord redeems his entire people from slavery and leads them and guides them through the wilderness to their liberation, to their promised land, to their true freedom. And so the scriptures are very clear in acclaiming the Lord God, the Redeemer of Israel. And this is part of a wider picture of God in the Old Testament. I know that in the Bible we have many, many books. It's as much a library as it is one book. And so each of them have their own gift, their own genius, but there is a sense in which the scriptures give us a great story that begins with the creation in Genesis and finds its zenith in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. In that great story, we see over and over again a picture of God, of the personality of God. The heart of God begins to emerge. This is important for us because we are mere human beings and creatures. How could we conceive of the nature of God on our own? And that God unveils for us his heart. For we learn there in the scriptures what the New Testament asserts, that God is love, that God is a communion of love. And so what we see across the scriptures is the Lord's fidelity to us. He doesn't ever give up on us, no matter how many times we fail, turn away, reject him, or sin. The Lord is faithful to us. In fact, the picture you begin to see is that the Lord longs to bring us back. The great sin in Genesis, the original sin, is the failure to trust in divine mercy, in divine providence. It is a turning away from God, a desire to kind of be our own little gods. And God is constantly trying to repair that rift that is opened by that original sin. An original sin which leads also to terrible injustice among people. If you look at the nature of God's liberation of his people in Israel, you see a contrast between the ways of the world, exploitation, domination, violence, and that of God, which is life and love and liberation. The power of God is not about control or selfishness. The power of God, as the power of love, always wants the beloved to thrive and to have life. It cannot exploit or misuse. And so the scriptures give us this picture of the heart of God. But they also give to us a less attractive picture of ourselves. Certainly, we see the high calling that we have as children of God, made in the image and likeness of God. We see not only our sacred origins, but our sacred calling. But we also see how in every generation, we fall back into fear and selfishness, how we take advantage of one another and forget God. We turn away. That picture is a kind of tragic element, certainly of the Old Testament, an unresolved tragic element until the appearance of the Christ. And here it is that God surprises his people. Because for many centuries, we thought the only way back to God was by fixing ourselves. That's where God steps in with a plan of grace beyond our wildest imagining. As it says in that beautiful exultet at the Easter Vigil, to save a sinner, God gave his beloved Son. There is a kind of transaction here, but it's not about the transaction or the price. It's about the truth of the heart of the Father, who would pay any price, even that of his beloved Son, to redeem us from slavery to sin and death. It should, I hope, fill our hearts with a sense of awe and gratitude what our God has done for us in the gift of his Son Jesus, who shows us who we are called to be, who we were made to be. For just as we see that picture of God's own heart, in Jesus we see the truth of who we are, a mirror that God holds up to us. For this Jesus, what does he show to us? He shows us the opposite of the original sin. He shows us perfect fidelity, perfect trust, above all in the nature of his self-offering on the cross, but really throughout his ministry, you see Jesus entrust himself entirely to the will of God. He does not seek his own will, his own benefit. There is no ego. He trusts, he gives. He loves and lives for others. And in that gift of himself, you see even in his own ministry, the outpouring of what God can do with that. As the blind see and the lame walk, the sick are healed, the dead arise, sinners find forgiveness and mercy, the lost are found. All of this flowing from the heart of Jesus, who now reveals to us in the clearest sense the truth of God's own interior life, that communion of love, and reveals to us our origins in God and our sacred calling and our destiny to be brought back into communion with the heart of God. This is why we acclaim Jesus our Redeemer, the one who gives everything to liberate and to save us. It's a beautiful word. I hope one we think about, pray about, and give thanks for on a regular basis. But one last piece of this great mystery is that this Jesus, who ministered and walked the roads of Galilee and Judea, desired to establish for himself a family. Just as God would be Redeemer to Israel, a member of the family, so Jesus creates now a new Israel, a new family that welcomes men and women of every nation of goodwill. And so throughout his ministry, you see him gathering to himself his disciples, instructing them, sharing life with them. He says to them so beautifully, "I don't call you servants. I call you friends. There's no greater love than this, than to lay down your life for a friend." He promises them that he will not leave them orphans, but remain with them even after his death and resurrection. For he will give to them the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete, to lead them, to guide them, strengthen and console them. He forms this new family even as he is dying on the cross. Even the night before he died, when you would think he would have been thinking of himself, he was thinking and praying for them, for us. And from the cross, behold your mother, behold your son, that new family of faith. From the cross, we see the Spirit handed over. When he dies, we're told he gives over the Spirit. And from his wounded side, after the soldier pierces him with the lance, the blood and the water, they burst forth. The springs of living water prophesied by Jesus himself with the woman at the well in Samaria. The gifts of baptism and Eucharist that sustain and give life to this new family, empowered and guided by his Spirit. Our presence here today, our desire to respond to the Lord with our own trust and fidelity, with our own faith, this is part of his plan for the world. He calls us to himself, and he invites us to respond freely. He will never force us. He doesn't dominate. He doesn't control. He loves. He empowers. He invites. He draws us to his heart, and he longs for us to respond with our own love and trust. For when we do that, we take a share in his own work of healing and of reconciliation. We know not only the promise of eternal life, but a renewal of life here and now. The Holy Scriptures, they promise this too, that God wishes to renew his people, to recreate his people. You and I, as baptized members of the body of Christ, we have a sacred calling to be recreated in his image. It's why on this holiest of days, the church asks everyone across the world in hundreds of languages, billion of people strong, asks all of us to remember the day of our baptism when we were made a part of that body of Christ and to reaffirm and renew the promises of our baptism. I hope and pray that this Easter season will be a time of renewal and new life for you, for your family and friends. And maybe above all, I hope that this great feast will mark a renewal of your own faith and the quality of your response to the Lord. He longs to know you, to love you, to strengthen you, to walk with you on the journey of your life. Give him your love, your trust, your faith. And so I ask you now to rise as we ask the Lord to strengthen us by the renewal of our baptismal promises.
Dear brothers and sisters, through the Paschal mystery, we have been buried with Christ in baptism, so that we may walk with him in newness of life. And so now that our Lenten observance is concluded, let us renew the promises of holy baptism, by which we once renounced Satan and all his works, and promised to serve God in the Holy Catholic Church. And so I ask you, do you renounce Satan and all his works?
I do.
and all his empty show. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? May Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and bestowed upon us the forgiveness of our sins, keep us by his grace in Christ Jesus our Lord for eternal life. Amen. With confidence in divine providence, we offer our needs and those of our world.
That the Church may manifest in tangible ways the truth of Christ's triumph over death, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That oppression, prejudice, slavery, hatred, and injustice of every sort may be put to death through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Christ, risen from the dead, will bless our country and free us from fear and falsehood. We praise to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the grace to persevere in living our Catholic faith, especially through fidelity to Sunday Mass and the sacraments, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those inscribed in our parish prayer intention book, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our deceased parents, relatives, friends, members of the Cathedral Purgatorial Society, members of the Woods family, Dr. Ronald Morrissey, and especially Margaret Kotoya, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, hear these prayers we speak, as well as those that remain in the quiet of our hearts. If they are in accord with your holy will, grant them, for we ask them with confidence through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Pray, friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Exultant with paschal gladness, O Lord, we offer the sacrifice by which your church is wondrously reborn and nourished through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but on this day above all to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death, and by rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." the mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saints Peter and Paul, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, me, your unworthy servant, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Amen.
Let us pray. May the grace of this Paschal sacrament abound in our minds, we pray, O Lord, and make those you have set on the way of eternal salvation worthy of your gifts, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If I may just express a few words of gratitude to all those who helped to make this a beautiful liturgy and praise of God. I'm grateful to all of the volunteers who came together to prepare and decorate the church for the Easter feast. I'm very grateful to my colleague, Sister Elizabeth, for her careful attention to detail and wonderful care of this building. I would like to express gratitude to all of the ministers of this Mass, but in a particular way, we owe a debt of gratitude to Monsignor Mancini, Dr. Farone, and the Gregorian Concert Choir for helping us to pray this day. Thank you for the glorious noise you have made with us and for us today. And last but not least, many thanks to each and every one of you for your faith and for your presence and prayerfulness this day. Christ is risen. Christ is truly risen. Nothing will ever be the same, including you and I. So I hope that this day will bring you the blessings of joy and of hope and a renewal of your faith, of your family life, and of all of your love. The Lord be with you.
And with you. Bow down for the blessing.
May Almighty God bless you through today's Easter solemnity, and in his compassion, defend you from every assault of sin. Amen. Amen. And may he who restores you to eternal life in the resurrection of his only begotten endow you with the prize of immortality. Amen. Amen. Now that the days of the Lord's passion have drawn to a close, may you who celebrate with gladness the Paschal feast come with Christ's help and exulting in spirit to those feasts that are celebrated in eternal joy. Amen. Amen. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Go in peace, alleluia, alleluia.